Hey, good morning. I just want to say hello, hello, and welcome to Bethany Northeast. I'm Andrew Platter, worship director and your friend. And we are jumping into a pretty fun set of verses in scripture this morning. John's going to unpack some things this morning later from Psalm 104. And I'm just going to read a little bit of the ending of Psalm 104. It starts at verse 31, says, May the Lord and the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in his works. He who looks at the earth and it trembles, who touches the mountains and they smoke. I will sing to the Lord all my life. I will sing praises to my God as long as I live. May my meditations be pleasing to him as I rejoice in the Lord. So, this verse talks about God being this powerful God who just he touches the mountains, and we know mountains are very big, some unsurmountable, and they smoke, right? They respond, and yet we have this chance to go and be close to God, right? He is our the friend of sinners. He's the one who restores us. So as we come to God, we ask him to restore us this morning. To know him, and as we approach this throne of grace, we know that we are made worthy by Christ. Otherwise, we can't do this. We can't come to him. So let's sing together. Here I am, unworthy again, confessing my need, a beautiful need. Confessing how anxious, unsettled I am. I need your delight, Father of life. I need your delight, Father of life. Hold me close, away from the bitter, out of the cold. Wash me in the river, lay me beside still waters, green pastures, and I'll find rest. I'll find my rest in you. I'll find my rest in you. Here I am on this new day, confessing my need, a wonderful need, giving this life up to you. I need your delight, Father of life. I need your delight. Father of life, hold me close, away from the bitter, out of the cold. Wash me in the river, lay me beside still water. I'll find my
I'll find my rest, I'll find my rest in you. I'll find my rest in you. Yeah, you. Yeah, I'll find my rest, I'll find my rest in you. I'll find my rest. I'll find my rest, I'll find my rest in you. I'll find my rest in you.
Lord Jesus, we thank you again for the ways that you're working in our lives, in this life that is so full of twists and turns. We know that when we can draw from a well that does not run dry, that we can be filled up and changed and made new through only the power of Jesus. So we do call on you this morning in our Northeast community to be that renewer of our spirits, renewer of our lives, that the muscles that have gone a little numb from this past year, that they would begin to have that blood coursing through, that we would be able to get up and use the gifts that you've given us to serve others and to show the love of Christ to those who need you. I think that's everybody, God. We just know we need you so much. In Jesus' name, amen. Again, glad you're here.
Thank you so much, Andrew, for leading us into worship this morning. My name's Jack. I'm Bethany Northeast lead pastor. Welcome. If you're with us for the first time in a long time, today is the fourth Sunday of Asian American Pacific Islander Heritage Month, AAPI month. And if you've been around Bethany Northeast for any length of time, you know that we've made a commitment over the past couple of years to celebrate these various heritage months throughout the year, as we seek to center different voices and experiences in different communities that make up the wider body of Christ, but voices and communities that are often not centered within the church, especially within churches like maybe ours that are predominantly white. And so it's our hope in centering these voices and these respective communities that we can learn collectively as a body, be informed, inspired, challenged by the stories and the wisdom of other communities. Our hope is also to join with these particular communities. If you think about AAPI and just the past several months with what happened in Atlanta and what's happened in the wake of the pandemic, we want to stand in solidarity with the larger body of Christ, specifically with the AAPI community this particular month, as we all work together collectively for racial justice and reconciliation. That's the work God's called us to, according to scripture. So that said, a couple ways we are doing this month. One is, and John can put this slide up, we have an online learning module that we've created for you to engage with. And here's the link to that. This is just putting in the chat. There's a link to that in case you're curious. This can be done on your own, and it can also be done together. It's a way in which you can engage Asian American Pacific Islander heritage and theology and stories. Again, you can just do it at your own pace. There are several weeks to this. We're in the second week of it. And then also together, if you'd like to be in a learning community at 4 p.m. today, we'll have the second of our 3 weeks of gathering together. The first two last week and this week are via Zoom. The third week is going to actually be in person, socially distanced in person, and you can learn more about that through this website. And so 4 p.m. today, we just only ask that you do the work before coming, if at all possible. So do some of the reading and learning and then join in. We'd love to have you there. So another way that we're celebrating this Heritage Month AAPI is by listening to learning from someone from within the community itself, someone who's thinking about issues of race, justice, theology, and might just challenge and inspire us. And so that's it today. I want to invite us to hear a word from the author and scholar and theologian, Grace Kim, who I quoted a couple weeks ago, She's a professor of theology at Earlham School of Religion, and she's an author of over 20 books. But she talks a lot about the Spirit of God, God as Spirit. And today is, if you aren't familiar with the liturgical calendar, is Pentecost Sunday. So this is the Sunday the church globally celebrates the outpouring of the Spirit on the church. And from Acts chapter 2, where we see that happening after the resurrection, the Spirit is given to the church. We are given the presence of God through the Spirit to be the presence of Christ, to be healing and hope. And I think of that in times like this, where there's so much need for healing and hope. The Spirit is so much, so vital right now. And so I want to read a quick scripture and then this quote from Grace Kim, and then I'll pray. The scripture I want to read is from Joel chapter 2. And this is what God says about the outpouring of the Spirit. God says, in those days, I'll pour out, and think of it like today. In those days, I'll pour out my Spirit on all humanity. Your children, if you have children, think of it like this. Your children will boldly and prophetically speak the word of God. Your elders will dream dreams. Your young people will see visions. No one will be left out. In those days, I will offer my Spirit to all people, both male and female. In the heaven above and on the earth below, I'll give signs of my intervention. Blood, fire, clouds of smoke. The sun will become a void of darkness. The moon will become blood, just as before the great and dreadful day of the Eternal One arrives. Then everyone who calls in the name of the Eternal One will be saved. And that's the promise of the outpouring of the Spirit. And here's what Grace Kim says about this idea of the Spirit being poured out upon us. She says the Spirit needs to be understood as movement. The Spirit goes between, moves through the borders and boundaries in space and time. The Spirit moves in the in-between spaces that marginalized people occupy, the hybrid spaces to which marginalized are often relegated, because the Spirit is able to move into all places, all people's lives. The Spirit can reach these hard-to-get spaces and bring healing and wholeness to everyone. As the Spirit moves into these marginalized spaces, wonderful things begin to occur, she says. The Spirit needs to be understood, she goes on to say, as movement. The Spirit goes between, moves through the borders, boundaries of space and time, in between spaces that marginalized people occupy, hybrid spaces where they're relegated. Oh, I think I already read that. I apologize for reading it twice. Well, I think I missed my quote, but I wrote down the same thing twice. So I'm going to end with that. That's me. If you don't know me, I make mistakes. So I love the idea of the Spirit as a movement, going between, moving between borders of boundary and space and time, and bringing healing and hope. And so I want to pray right now. We're in a space where there feels like there's kind of boundaries between us sometimes, where we might experience marginalization. Certainly people within different communities like the API community feel marginalization, and we want to stand with them. And it's the Spirit of God, what I'm trying to say, I think what Grace Kim reminds us, that brings that connection and brings that healing and wholeness. And so let me pray, and then I'll invite John to come lead us in opening God's word together. God, thank you that your Spirit, as we understand it as movement, can move through borders, boundaries, and space and time, God. I just resonate so deeply with what Dr. Kim has said here, that there are boundaries and borders right now that we are very acquainted with. And there's marginalization occurring all over. We specifically lament the marginalization that the AAPI community has experienced this last year. It makes us angry, God, that people who are created in your image would experience marginalization. Yet we thank you, God, that even in these hard to get to spaces that we as human beings, we feel like we cannot break through, that your Spirit brings healing, wholeness, reconciliation, and repair. So God, would your Spirit, we ask for your Spirit, God, which was poured out on the first church, would be poured out on our church, that you would inspire us as this word from Joel reminds us that you would give us visions, dreams. You give us boldness to be the presence of your Spirit today. We pray in the name of Christ, who is our great hope. Amen.
Good morning. It's great to be with you this morning. And Jack, thanks for sharing that quote from Grace Kim. I love that. Just to, before we get into the word, that there's this, the thought and image of the Holy Spirit just moving in and through everything, to me sounds generational too, right? So like the work that we're doing now should transcend our being, right? Should transcend what our space in this time, through the work of the Holy Spirit, should multiply and go through the next generation, so that they don't have to go through those same things and don't have to be doing the same work over and over and over again. And so when I think of the Holy Spirit moving in and through, I just think of him, the Holy Spirit moving and having his way through every aspect of life, but also every generation. And so thank you for sharing that from Grace Kim this morning, Jack. Well, my name is John, Children, Youth, and Family Pastor here. And this morning I have the pleasure of introducing a new series to us. I've kind of studied through. We're going to take about 3 weeks and talk and learn around this concept of some old English, be thou my vision. I'm smiling because I love hearing old English and King James type of verbiage, but it's be thou my vision. You might see that often. This week specifically, we're going to look at Psalms 104. Andrew spoke towards kind of the bottom half of that. I'm going to read it for us, but we're going to pretty much study around looking around, right? So vision in terms of looking around, what does it look when you look around today? What does that look like? We're going to be honest with what we see, but also we're going to have this heavenly perspective. I want to invite you to have a heavenly perspective as well as we study. Next week, we're going to look at looking back and what do we learn from looking back? And then the Sunday after, looking ahead and what are we looking forward to and what is the Holy Spirit speaking into the future? We're also celebrating our graduating seniors on that Sunday as well. That's the 6th of June. So I'm going to read for us Psalms 104. And I want to invite you to do something. If you haven't read this portion of scripture, oftentimes in Psalms, you'll hear a pouring out of the psalmist's heart. Usually David is what we usually give him credit for, but you'll hear this pouring out of a heart, right? So he's either confessing or praising or magnifying God in some way. And this is no different in that. And so what I like to do with Psalms often is just close my eyes. I want to invite you to close your eyes. If you have kids, if you have one eye open, that's still holy enough, but kidding. Close your eyes and just try to really imagine this scripture as it's written. If you could just picture it in image and imagery form. So just go ahead and I'm going to invite you to close your eyes as I read this. And I'm going to also put the words up on the screen if you want to follow along in that way as well. Psalms 104, verse 1 through 9 says this: praise the Lord, my soul. Lord, my God, you are very great. You are clothed with splendor and majesty. The Lord wraps himself in light as with a garment. He stretches out the heavens like a tent and lays the beams of his upper chambers on their waters. He makes the clouds his chariot and rides on the wings of the wind. He makes winds his messengers, flames of fire his servants. He set the earth on its foundations. It can never be moved. You covered it with the watery depths as with a garment. The waters stood above the mountains. But at your rebuke, the waters fled. At the sound of your thunder, they took flight. They flowed over the mountains. They went down into the valleys to the place you assigned them. You set a boundary they could not cross. Never again will they cover the earth. That's Psalms 104, verses 1 through 9. It's a pretty vivid portion of scripture if you're describing just the majestic and splendor of God. I don't know if you've got a picture of it, but I see this creator and just in a majestic way, like, man, this is God. This is how the psalmist is imagining and even putting words to what and who God is as he looks around at what he's done at the same time. I mean, I could, I don't know if you do this, if you're doing a devotion in the midday or the morning or night, but oftentimes I feel like we can just soak in scripture like this. Just sit and just listen and just be silent before God as we take in just how majestic he is. And this is one of those scriptures to do that in. I remember not too long ago, Judah turned 2 years old and we were excited, but also fearful because his birthday is December 24th, which means he gets like 1,000 gifts and we can't stop them. They just come. And 1 year, well, 2 years ago, a year and a half, they were just showing up on the doorstep. Entire month of December, we're just like, we can't. I don't know how to disperse these things. And so we decided, let's give them to him kind of one by one, kind of like slow it down a little bit so that he'd appreciate them. And I remember one gift in particular, we had got him from Target. It was a Spider-Man toy. And if you have kids listening, I'm so sorry. If Spider-Man is a triggering word that causes them to go and put the show on, I'm so sorry. But it was the toy. And we brought it in. I said, Judah, we have a gift for you. He goes, and I kid you not, sits on the floor, closes his eyes like this. Like he's waiting for his gift. Kid loves gifts. And we walk in with it, and I will never forget his face. Sigurd and I both looked at each other, and we're just like dying in laughter because he went, whoa! Like he just like lit up, and we were like, we've only provided for you for like 2 years, and you've never given us that expression with anything, any meal we've cooked, anything we've done. And he just lit up. And we tried that again, and we said, okay, this is great. 2 weeks later, we did another thing, and he just went, oh, that's cool. Right, we never got that same expression again, ever, and I wish we recorded it. The thing is, I feel like we read scripture sometimes in that way, right? There's that invitation to read it with this childlike awe and wonder. And sometimes life allows you to do that, if I can use that phrase, life allows. But sometimes there's things that prevent that moment of awe and splendor, imagination, wonder happening when reading a scripture like this. As we look around, let me invite you, let me remind you this next 3 weeks, have that moment of awe and wonder as if you were opening a brand new thing every single time. Allow God to just wow you and awe you. And as we talk about looking around and dive into a little bit of what it looks like around Be Thou My Vision, vision is talked about in a couple of ways or a number of ways. One of the ways that you might hear vision used as a noun, which is the state of being able to see, right? I can see that. I have vision. Another way that vision is used is in a verb tense, right? So simply to imagine. And if I can put those things together, if you'd made a sentence with it, you can simply say that vision is the ability to see and imagine, right? Be able to see and imagine. You can vision something together. You can do this thing together. If you can see it, you can achieve it, right? Is that how it goes? So as I look around and I ask myself and I assess what's happening in the world around me, and you might ask yourself, what's happening in the world around you? This is the question that comes to mind. What brings you to a posture of humility and understanding? As you look around, not what is serving me, what looks so amazing, what can I bring into my, what brings you to a posture of humility and understanding? Ask myself this, because I think it's easy when I look around to fixate on things that I once valued, that I once held of high importance. And I might make assessments based on that and go, this is how I thought it was before. This is how, and I might look around and go, man, this is God. You're not showing up like you used to. Or God, I'd rather you come in this way. And God, I can't. When we look around with this unbalanced approach, it could hurt us. We're people. We do this, though. I think God challenges us different in this. As I read this passage and think around, looking around, God calls us higher to look and perhaps even adapt a threefold approach, and the threefold approach of looking around, looking behind, and looking ahead. And when doing that in a healthy manner together, it leads to peace. Jack mentioned wholeness and alignment with the Holy Spirit of God. That alignment, by the way, not only brings intimacy with God, but it brings intimacy with people. Alignment isn't just a thing that we get on the same page with God. It's also, it should spread this way. it should bring us in alignment with the community around us as well. Alignment is more than agreeing on the same thing. It's more than just going, I hate what you're thinking, but I still love you. Right? That's the most commonly used Christian phrase. That's gotta go. Alignment has nothing to do with if you agree. Alignment has everything to do with where you are in your relationship with God. Is this straight? And is this coming out the way it should? So if this is good, this should come out this way. And I say this all the time because I strongly believe in alignment with the Holy Spirit. What does it look like to be in perfect alignment with the Holy Spirit of God? Because if we're not in alignment, you can't truly have peace and wholeness. It's hard. If you're not in alignment, whose peace and whose wholeness are you holding on to? Your own? Right? So as we look around, we got to start with aligning ourselves with the Holy Spirit of God. And that, I think, I asked myself as reading this passage, like, why is looking around so essential? You know, you might go, why? Like, what makes it so important? Yes, we get alignment. We understand that. But also, there's these few thoughts. One of the more important thoughts is, I think you become aware of your Creator. If our mission, Matthew 28, 19 through 20, Vacation Bible School, learn this by heart. If our mission is to go and make disciples, right, and proclaim the good news, how can we go without a deep awareness of our Creator? How can we go if we haven't sat with our Creator and just looked around and just went, God, let me just soak in who you are. Let me just soak in and have a deep connection with you before I press on, before I go and do this, that, and that. How can I do that if I don't have a deep understanding of the majestic and splendor, or even a curiosity of our Creator? I like food, so I'm going to liken it to food. And even though I can't have this, it just came to mind. But it's as if you walk into a Baskin and Robbins, and the employee that's standing at the counter says, hey, I know you're here at Baskin and Robbins. This ice cream's good. But Molly Moon's, that's where you got to go. What are you doing here? Which Molly Moon's is better. We know that. There's no debate. But it's as if you walk into a Baskin and Robbins, and someone's coming to you for something amazing, and then they go, you know what, though? Molly Moon's is actually a lot better, right? In fact, they taste better. It looks better. I know more about Molly Moon's than I actually do about the place that I am. Are you catching what I'm saying here? We got to know who our Creator is, right? We're not selling a product, so please don't get me wrong there. But we have to know because people are hungry and they're searching. When the Holy Spirit moves in and between things, he shakes things up. And when you shake things up, people begin to look and they begin to become hungry and they begin to look for what shook it to begin with. And they start looking at things and how do I come connected? I have this desire and this need to be connected to a community or connected to a church or connected to a body or something bigger than myself. How do I do that? And I think if we know who our Creator is, and if we look around and we understand the majestic and the splendor of who he is, it helps us to better represent who that person is. So that when people come looking, we can go, this is why we do what we do. This is why we love what we do. Has nothing to do with our plan, our personal agenda, but has everything to do with who the Creator is, which comes by looking around. We have to become aware of who our Creator is and have to love our Creator. That's number one. Second, I think it's clear that the community around us will benefit. It's essential because the community around us benefits. A lot of you might have done this. I'll admit, I've become like a COVID gardener, weed whacker, whatever it is. I wouldn't call myself like a plant papa. I can't believe I used that term. We'll have to cut that out. But I don't enjoy gardening, but I like to cut things and use big tools to cut weeds unnecessarily. It's fun work. And as I've been doing that over the last couple of weeks, I've learned there's a couple ways you do things. And as I was kind of learning how to get around some edges, I found and discovered something that I wasn't looking for. And if you're an arachnophobic person, if you have a fear of spiders, I'm warning you now to divert your eyes, but I'm going to show you something that creeped up on me. And I had no idea it was there. So, there it is. Tried to warn you. in the middle there. Let's see if I can circle it for you. Right here, that's just, those are believed to be garden spiders. And what they do, hopefully I get this right, they've grouped together. Now let me just give you quickly, this is right near the back door. So I'm thinking worst case scenario, I see those things. Once those things go their separate ways, I'm hoping they don't come in the middle of the night and haunt me. I have a deep fear of spiders, and I think you get the point now. But the interesting thing about these spiders is they stay together, they group together. And before I did anything, right, because you want to not touch things you don't know, before I did anything, I read up on it. And the thing that's interesting about garden spiders, when they're in that ball-shaped form, they stay together. They're bonded together because they're becoming, they're nurtured, they're growing, they're getting health, they're getting everything they need, their food. And then once they're strong enough, they go their separate ways, right? So they're together, then they go their separate ways. It's interesting that if you even mess with them, if you tap them, you touch them, they scatter. And that's their first inclination so that they're safe. When they're brought back together, it's only then when they're brought back and they're whole and they're healthy, then they do go and they become a menace to your garden. Or in better ways, they become a light to the ecosystem, right? They continue to let things flourish. It was interesting as I was looking at these spiders that what they do is they group together in health and in wholeness. They don't mess with anything. It's so peaceful. They do their thing together and then they're dispersed and they go. Everything, as I look around, everything is such, God is like, man, I am in every single thing you can think of. Even as terrifying as a ball of hundreds of spiders just lurking down near your door. Every single thing. His image, his plan, his design is in all of his creation. If we would just slow down and look around, man, imagine what we'd see. Psalms 104 verse 5 speaks to me. It says, he set the earth on its foundation. It can never be moved. These aren't just philosophical thoughts. He is the foundation. When you look around, I know it's like mind-blowing, but he's the foundation. He is the foundation. When you look around, everything is set and everything has been set based on what he has already determined to be the foundation. That is so good. When things go haywire, it doesn't matter. He's coming back. The foundation is Jesus. The foundation is God. He's already set the foundation for us. These things come to mind and I'm reminded by them. But I have to be reminded to stay aligned with the Holy Spirit of God so that when I look around, I can see through that lens so that I can see and I can vision and imagine, what is God seeing in this? What is God imagining in this? Last couple thoughts here. I've said it in the beginning a little bit, but you begin to come in alignment with God. This is one of the things. Why is it essential to look around? You begin to come into alignment with the Spirit of God. It's his alignment. It's by his alignment that we're able to function and really bring peace and wholeness to our lives and the lives around us. Right? You can argue over the past year, we've been scattered as a community in some ways. And even you may feel out of alignment in certain different spaces of life. But we have to look around. And as we look around, last couple of thoughts is, what are you choosing to become fixated on, or what are you choosing to care about as you look around? And I have to draw the line here and let you know that there is a difference in that. One of the things that we become fixated on, I think yearly, as a country, as a nation, this isn't deep, but they're fireworks. Fireworks. I don't know about you, but I watch fireworks like a madman. They go off, I'm watching. That's the last one. That's the finale. That's the big one. That's it. And more, they come, and I just fixate on the sky for night, for a whole night, for a few hours. Just, my neck is breaking, but got to see fireworks. I become fixated on them. I have to see how they explode, what they do. It's fascinating. But as I think about in relation to becoming, to come into alignment with the Holy Spirit of God and what that looks like as we look around and concerning our vision, I have to remind myself to be fixated on the right things, on the things that God is fixated on, right? I want to care and I want to have deep concern for worries of my own and those that are around me and doubts, right? And the weather, like these are real things that we care about in health. Like these are good things to care about, that we don't want to fixate on, but we want to care about them, right? Worries, fears, doubts, those things that matter, right? Our livelihood, those things we care about, and we have to. So don't get me wrong there. But scripturally, in a deeper way that's connected to the Holy Spirit of God, I'm convinced that we are to fixate on justice, on peace, on wholeness, on alignment with His Spirit. And those are the things that are concerning the heart of God. Those are the things that I want to fix it on as I look around. Where is peace? Where can I bring peace? Where can I bring justice? Where can I bring wholeness? Not just to my Christian friends, everywhere. This isn't a thing. Everyone's invited to the table, right? This is not just a Christian thing. Where can I bring these things? And where can I bring alignment to the world around me? And am I in line? I'm going to read this scripture to you and then invite Andrew back on. Micah says this. The book of Micah, it says, what can we bring to the Lord? Should we bring Him a burnt offering? Should we bow before the Most High God with offerings of yearly calves? Should we offer Him thousands of rams and 10,000 rivers of olive oil? Should we sacrifice our firstborn children to pay for our sins? Verse 8 says this, no, O people, the Lord has told you what is good. And that is what it requires of you, to do what is right, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with God. And so friends, as you look around, let me challenge and encourage you. Become obsessed with doing what is right, with loving mercy, with walking humbly with God, and fixate on those things. As a community, let's live and lead a life that is peace-bringing, that is whole, and that's in line with God, where we're fully in alignment with God, or we begin that work of becoming aligned with God, because we know it's not an overnight thing. But let us work towards that goal together as a community, as we look around and envision what God is doing around us. I'm going to pray and then invite Andrew to come in and lead us in a song. God, we thank You for this morning. God, we thank You for Your Psalm 104, 1 through 9. God, as we look around and we just sit in awe of Your majesty and Your splendor and what You have created, God, and what is around You, God, we can become numb sometimes, but God, I ask You, God, just to shake us up. Cause us, God, to look deeper, God. Cause us to look deeper than what's in front of us, what we think we know, what we think we're sitting. God, cause us to just blow everything up, God. You are the foundation. Let us start from that foundation. God, reshape our minds in this season, in this series. Give us a jump start, God, and cause us to come into alignment with Your Holy Spirit so that we can bring bringers of peace, so we can bring wholeness, and so that we can do that in ways that are healthy and honoring to You. We thank You so much, God. We love You. In Jesus' name, amen.
Lord, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without You, Lord, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need You. Oh, I need You. Every hour I need You. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need. Your grace is more, your grace is found, Lord, is where You are, where You are. Lord, I am free, holiness is Christ in me, where You are, Lord, I am free, my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you, Lord. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Hey, thanks, Andrew. Hey, family. Amy here. Such a good word. Thank you, John, for bringing that to us. It is perfectly aligned with Kids Connect this morning. Here's my Holy Spirit flame for the story this morning out of Acts 2. Are you aligned with the Holy Spirit? It is a miraculous and amazing truth that the Holy Spirit descended among the believers that day. And it's a celebration of the Holy Spirit indwelling in us and among us. And I'm still trying to comprehend exactly how that works, but I'm incredibly grateful that the Holy Spirit is guiding me and indwelling in me, that I might live out God's purposes for me. Wanted to just go ahead and give the announcements for the week in this benediction here. If you wanted to give to the church, there's ways to do that. You can do it online. You can do it on your phone or through the mail. And we are so incredibly thankful for your generosity. Be sure to keep updated with us. We want to know how to contact you. I've had a couple people give me their new addresses. Plenty of moving in this season. So be sure to update us with your contact info. We want to make sure that we are getting emails to you and mail to you. I send a lot of mail to kids, so be sure we have your address. Again, just to reiterate Jack's announcement, we have a three-part series for AAPI month. Today's module is really rich with information. I learned so much going through this module. Super amazing stuff. So I want to encourage you to go ahead and go online and do some learning and then connect from 4 to 5 p.m. In some discussion groups. A really rich time there. Common Compassion, this is the final week. This has been an incredible thing. One of my best friends works at the Commons. It's an incredible ministry. They're trying to buy either their current building or a building. So we have banded together with them and try to help raise some funds. They've already raised $275,000. Amazing, amazing. This is the final week to give though to Common Compassion. So please go ahead and do that if God has laid that on your heart. If you want to talk to me about Common Compassion, it's Aurora Commons. This is an amazing ministry. Okay, graduation. If you had a graduate who wants to be celebrated, eighth grade, high school, college, be sure to contact John. We want to make sure that your graduate is honored in this season. I'm really excited about some of our high school grads and eighth grade grads, celebrating them. So be sure we don't miss anybody. Post-service connections. These are weekly. Middle school group is meeting, high school group is meeting online, and Coffee and Connect for adults. Be sure to utilize that way to connect with the church. We are so grateful for all of you. Being in community with you is life-giving, and I am really grateful for these things, these opportunities. Thanks, family.
Just wait. Instead of trying in your own strength, you should just wait. Instead of calculating what will happen if you go wrong, you should just wait. My steps are ordered by the Lord. Yeah, I should just wait.